for this is the day that the Lord has made, and we are to be glad and rejoice in it. We are glad that you are worshiping with us online this morning. We are beginning our service with a scripture, Psalms 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God, and it is he who made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and of course, in his courts with praise. Give thanks unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Let us pray. Dear gracious, eternal God, our Father, Lord, we thank you, Father, and we give you glory. Have your way with us this morning, Father. Let your spirit fall fresh on us this morning. And when you do all that you're going to do, Father, we make covenant with you, Father, that we're going to give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
I said, praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Psalm says, I will call upon the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Are y'all ready to praise God in this place? Come on and put your hands together.
Oh, Good morning, New J, and welcome to New J Online. Go ahead and let us know how you're doing today, and let us know how your week has been. We're so glad you joined us online today. We want to make sure you know about Midweek Connection on Wednesdays at 6:30 a.m. and 7 p.m. via our conference call line. Pastor Jared would love to pray for you. He's personally taking your requests, reading them, and praying for you. If you have any prayer requests, please feel free to email him at PastorJarrett@newjtulsa.org. These are your morning announcements.
Well, somebody needs to know out there that in spite of what you may be going through right now, you don't have to worry, you don't have to fret, because your soul is anchored in the Lord. This is a good place for you to lift up your hands before we hear the word today. Come on and give him praise, because our soul is anchored in the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Hallelujah.
Though the storms keep on raging in my life, and sometimes it's hard to tell the night from day, still that hope that lies within is reassured as I keep my eyes upon the distant shore. I know he leads me safely to that blessed place he has prepared. blowing. Keep on blowing in your life. You gotta know that your soul has been anchored, Lord. My. Though the storm keep on raging in my life, and sometimes it's hard to tell the night from day. Still, that hope that lies within is reassured as I keep my eyes upon the distant shore. I know he leads me safely to that blessed place that he has prepared. Oh, but if storm by the waves and the currents that seem so fierce. But this is my testimony today. In the Word of God, I've got an anchor, yes I do. And it'll keep you steadfast and unmovable despite the time. Hey, ooh. But if storm don't cease, and if the winds keep on blowing in my life, my soul's been anchored. My soul's been anchored. The billows may roll, the breakers may bash. I shall not sway, 'cause he holds me fast. So dark today, clouds in the sky, I know it's alright, 'cause Jesus is down. Yeah. soul's been aching. My soul's been aching. My soul's been aching. Life puts me down. Jesus lifts me up. And he'll stick by me when the going gets tough. My soul's been aching. My soul's been aching. My soul has been anchored in my soul. Has been anchored in my soul. Has been anchored in the Lord.
You'll join me, friends, in the Gospel of John, chapter 20, and we'll begin our reading at verse 19 through verse 23. That's the Gospel of John, chapter 20, and we want to begin our reading at verse 19. And here's how the word of the Lord reads. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As my Father has sent me, even so I'm sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." The word of the Lord for the people of the Lord. I simply want to tag this text with this thought for this second installment of our series, Jesus Encounters. Freedom from fear. Freedom from fear. In 2015, the popular Christian group Bethel Music released a song entitled "No Longer Slaves." The simple yet powerful chorus of that song makes this declaration: "I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God." Friends, this song reminds us that all of us, while living life, we have two choices that we can make. We can either, choice number one, we can choose to live as children of God that embrace the perfect love that comes from God through the life of Jesus Christ. Or secondly, we can choose to live as slaves shackled by our own fear. But might I remind you early in the sermon this morning, child of God, that fear is self-imposed imprisonment. I'll say that again. Fear is self-imposed imprisonment. As a matter of fact, when we come to the Gospel of John, chapter 20, we find this, the resurrection story of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus has begun making his final appearances and encounters with those who would follow him. The Gospel of John, chapter 20, it begins with Jesus encountering Mary Magdalene. He would encounter her when she would be facing a moment of disappointment. But when we get to verse 19, child of God, Jesus makes another encounter. I like it because this encounter that we're going to look at today, it's an encounter with the disciples. It's 11 disciples left. Judas has hung himself, and at this account, while it is 11 left, only 10 are present because the text reminds us that Thomas is absent. But child of God, I like this encounter because this encounter finds the disciples not having faith, but having fear. They've locked themselves in a room. They've shut the door and locked themselves to the outside world. They are in this self-imposed prison because of the fear of the Jews. You see, they have watched their Christ be arrested, has been through kangaroo courts and has been crucified. And they believe that this Jewish community, this Jewish hierarchical community, this religious community of the day would do the same to them. And so because of their fear, they have locked themselves in a room. But I like it because when we read John chapter 20, Jesus shows up in their room, not knocking on the door, not tearing the door down, but he miraculously appears in the moment of their fear. Child of God, this is the disciples having a moment of fear. I know those who would follow Christ, those who would be followers of Jesus Christ, and those who would be the witnesses of Christ's miracles while he would be in the world. But now they are in fear instead of having faith. And child of God, perhaps I'm preaching to somebody here today in this virtual space. You too have been a follower of Jesus Christ. You too have been to Sunday school and Bible study. But can I tell you, all of us at moments will face difficult moments that will cause us to want to lock ourselves in our proverbial rooms and just live in fear. But the good news of this gospel this morning is that Christ will miraculously show up in our moment of fear to remind us that we are never alone. Y'all, this is called a theophany. It is Jesus showing up in miraculous ways to demonstrate his presence and his power to his people. And I mean, we've seen it throughout all of Scripture. I mean, from the Exodus story where God would show up at the Red Sea for the children of Israel, or with the three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, trapped in a fiery furnace, God shows up as the fourth man in the fire. And when we come to the Gospels, we find Jesus always miraculously showing up. But I got about 31 of you all that are watching me this morning that can testify in your own house that you've seen God show up in some spaces that you never thought that God could get there. But because he's God, he's present at the moment we need him the most. Look at it, child of God. Christ comes into a locked room. And I love it because when we look at our text this morning, here's what we learn, child of God. When we look at this second Jesus encounter, here's what we learn. We learn that Christ desires to release you from the imprisonment of fear. Let me say it again. It is Christ desires to release you from the imprisonment of fear. They tell me three times is the charm. I grew up in a church where they would say one for the Father, one for the Son, one for the Holy Ghost. So let me say it one more time. Here's what I'm trying to tell you. Christ desires to release you from the imprisonment of fear. I'm simply trying to tell you, child of God, God does not want your life to be surrounded by fear. God does not want your life to be lived in a prison. He wants you to be able to declare, who the Son sets free, he's free indeed. Come with me now, child of God. Let's zoom in on this encounter and let's take away some treasure for our daily living. When we lean into this text, we first discover that we are freed of fear by the presence of Jesus Christ. Yeah, it is when Christ shows up in our life, his presence makes us free. Look at it, child of God. In verse 19, they are in fear. But by verse 20, their fear has turned into joy. Because Christ's presence, the presence of Jesus Christ, our Christ's presence, makes us to know what freedom from fear feels like. Y'all, Aristotle says it like this. He says, he who has overcome his fears are truly free. Well, I agree with Aristotle that being delivered from fear causes you to enjoy freedom. I must testify with Aristotle that Christ is the only one that can make us to know this kind of freedom. I'm simply trying to tell you, child of God, that you can't manage your fears alone. You can't manage your fears and your moments of being scared by yourself. No, you need a power higher than this earthly power. You need the presence of Jesus Christ. I like it though, church. I like it because this text reminds us when we look at it that while they were together with one another, their fear grew in an unhealthy community. But when Jesus shows up, Jesus teaches us that joy grows in his presence. I think I'll say that again. Preach, Sean Jarrett. I'm doing the little best I can with this little script. In the presence of people, our fear grows. But in the presence of Christ, our joy grows. I'm simply trying to tell somebody this morning that every now and then, you got to check whose presence you're in. And that's what somebody needs to do right now in this moment where you're having a crisis. You must check those who are in your community, because if they're not adding joy to your life, maybe right now you need to give them the benediction that I learned when I was a child. May the Lord watch between me and thee while we're absent one from another. Amen. Because sometimes you have to change who presence you're in, because in the presence of people, your fear will grow, but in the presence of Christ, your joy will grow. Y'all, but look at it. I like it because when Christ shows up, according to verse 20, he gives them an opportunity to look at, child of God, to zoom in on proof of his presence. Christ does not want them to be mistaken about who just showed up. So he invites them to investigate his crucified body. He invites them to look at the wounds in his hands and the pierced wounds of his side. Here's what I like, child of God, that Christ has been wounded to remind us of who he is. No, I'm glad that I got a Jesus that has nails in his hands and he has a rivet in his side. Thanks be unto God that his wounds would be for our wholeness, his beating would be for our blessings, and his scars would be for our salvation. And no wonder Isaiah declares he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. I wonder though, child of God, when was the last time you looked for proof of God's presence in your life? Child of God, may I suggest on my way to my second movement of the text that everybody in abundance, every born again baptized believer should have proof that Christ has showed up in your life. I'm talking to somebody here today that you ought to have proof that Christ showed up in your life. Maybe it's the proof of a doctor's report that says you were sick, but now you're well. You ought to have proof. I'm preaching to somebody here today. You ought to have proof of Christ's presence, that one day you were defeated, but now you know victory as proof of Christ's presence. And perhaps I'm preaching to somebody here today that even in this moment of a corona crisis, you haven't lost your mind. And can I tell you what that is proof that Christ is present in your current predicament. Child of God, I got some more good news to tell you. Here it is. It is not that we're just freed of fear by the presence of Jesus Christ, but secondly, we are freed of fear with peace for future assignments. Look at it, child of God. In verse 21, look what Jesus says to the disciples. He says to them, "Peace be with you." These are the exact same words that he says in verse 19. It is like Jesus is he is on replay. He's on record. He is saying to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I'm sending you." Here it is, church. This is imparted peace. Child of God, this is not just simply Jesus giving a simple salutation. No, this is not a salutation of peace. This is an impartation of peace. This is not Jesus greeting the disciples with peace. This is Jesus giving the disciples peace. But can I tell you, church, that the only way you can give something, you first must have it yourself. And can I tell you, that's what I love about our Christ. He is Jehovah Shalom. He is the giver of peace because he is peace himself. But look at the child of God. He gives them peace for their future assignment. Church, this is John's recording of what we know as, that's popularly read in Matthew 28, known as the Great Commission. This is to remind them that while ministry is a difficult activity, that doing ministry in the world is a difficult activity, child of God, he wants to remind them that they can manage the difficult moments of ministry. They can manage the difficult moments of ministry because they have peace as their accompaniment. Child of God, maybe you don't understand what I'm saying. Over Christmas, me and my family had a chance to visit Branson, Missouri. And while there, my children, like they are, they had the great idea of going to Snowflakes Mountain. Snowflakes Mountain, y'all, is a simulation. It is a simulation of going down a mountain in Colorado on a snow tube. But child of God, I had an opportunity to sit at the bottom of the mountain and watch my daredevil children go down the mountain. But while I was there watching, I wasn't riding, I was watching. Let me say that one more time. I wasn't riding, I was watching. But while watching my boys go down Snowflakes Mountain, I had an opportunity to watch two different dads. One dad had a child who was in fear, but that dad was trying to make that child conquer his fears on his own. And so that dad kept saying, "You just go up the mountain and ride by yourself." But there was another dad that when his child began to cry and began to complain and began to be worried, I like what that dad did. That dad took that child by the hand, and that child that was in fear, by the time he got to the top of the mountain, he came down with peace because he had the accompaniment of his daddy. And here's the good news of our life, child of God, that when we are facing moments of difficulty and we're going down life's mountains, we don't have to manage them by ourselves. We have the accompaniment of our Christ that gives us peace in the most difficult times of our lives. But church, it's the final thing I want to lift for you. It's begging for me to say something. It's found in verse 22 and verse 23. That when freedom comes from fear, friend, we learn thirdly that we are freed from fear to live empowered in the world. I said, we are freed from fear to live empowered in the world. Look what he does. It is not just John writing about the Great Commission. But finally, John also writes now about the sending of the Holy Spirit to the life of the disciples and the early church. John, please note, church, John does not write from a historical point of view like Luke does in the book of Luke and in Acts of the Apostles. But John writes as a personal eyewitness of the resurrection of the resurrection of Jesus Christ and of the ascension of Christ and of the descending of the Holy Spirit. And John wants us to know, child of God, that we don't, that the Holy Spirit and the crucifixion of Christ and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, they were all one simultaneous action that happened for the birth of the early church. It is the sending of the Spirit. It is the sending of the Spirit. I like it, church. Jesus says to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." No, you don't earn the Holy Spirit. No, you don't work for the Holy Spirit. No, you don't tarry for the Holy Spirit. Here's what you do. You receive the Holy Spirit. But here's the good news of the gospel, that when I say yes to the resurrection of Jesus, the crucifixion of Christ and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, at that moment when I put my trust in that, the finished work of Christ, I then can receive the Holy Spirit. And can I tell you what you do with any gift you receive? All you do is lift up your hands and say thank you for the gift. And as a matter of fact, right now in your home, you ought to just take 30 seconds and lift up your hands and tell God thank you that you have received the power of the Holy Spirit. But it is not just the sending of the Spirit, child of God. It is finally the stewarding of the Spirit. All right. It is not just you receiving the Holy Spirit. It is then what will you do with what you receive. I like it. I'm done. I'm finished. I'll bid you a good morning. We can go eat our breakfast. You can have your toast, drink your black coffee, and we'll have a good after Sunday afternoon. But here's what I want to tell you, child of God. It is the stewarding of the Spirit. He then talks about forgiveness. It is that when we receive the Holy Spirit does not just help us to shout, run, jump, do laps, and speak in tongues. No, the Holy Spirit helps us to walk right and to live right and to do the difficult spiritual disciplines of the Bible. It is stuff like forgiveness. Can I tell y'all, I'm done, but forgiving people is hard work. But I think I need to remind you, church, I think I need to remind you, child of God, that all forgiven people should be forgiving people. You didn't catch what I said. All people who have been forgiven should be people who do forgiving. And many of us, we want to thank God for God forgiving us, but we don't want to forgive nobody. But here's the word for your life this morning, is that when you have God's power in your life, you should be trying to let things go and to move on with life and to forgive people that have wronged you. I'm preaching to somebody here today. You have watched that person die. They are in a grave and you have yet to forgive them. But can I tell you, child of God, the Holy Spirit is giving you power to forgive them, to do for them what you cannot do in your own strength. But I'm also preaching to somebody. It is not them you need to forgive. It's you that you need to forgive. You thought you was perfect. You thought you would never make a mistake. You would never embarrass your family. You would never get caught in a life of sin. And so you're finding it hard to forgive yourself. But I came to announce a word to you this morning, child of God, woman of God, man of God, to tell you God still loves you and he's put his Holy Spirit in you to empower you to even forgive yourself. I'm done. I'm done. I'm closing up my Bible. I'm finished. I'm done. I'm happy in this church, though. It ain't many people here with me, but I'm happy in this church because forgiveness is a dirty job. My brother, my elder brother, Pastor Corey Morris, the pastor of the Bethel Baptist Church of Brooklyn, New York, when talking about the first cry from the cross, Father, forgive them, when Jesus says it, for they know not what they do, he calls it a dirty job. What he's doing is he's talking about a reality television show where the reality television show, it features people doing dirty jobs. But the tagline of the reality television show is, somebody has to do it. Can I tell you that the reason we can do the dirty job of forgiveness is because Christ has already completed the dirty job of forgiveness. Y'all, you come on, come run to Calvary with me. When they nailed his hands, that was him doing the dirty job. When they riveted his feet, that was him doing the dirty job. When they put a spike on his head, that was him doing the dirty job. When he died from the sixth to the ninth hour, that was him doing the dirty job. They laid him in a borrowed grave, that was him doing the dirty job. He stayed there all day Friday. He stayed there, I feel my help now, all night Saturday night. But early Sunday morning, he finished the dirty job. When he got up,
with all power. I know I can't hear you. You're not in the church, but you ought to lift your hands in the living room and give God praise that he did the dirty job. And no wonder we sing, what can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I know I ain't supposed to holler online, but I'm glad about it. I said I'm glad about it. Tell somebody he did the dirty job. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's somebody, you're watching, you're worshiping with us in this virtual space. You're struggling with this area of forgiveness. You don't know how to forgive yourself. You're struggling to forgive yourself. I want to tell you, Christ has forgiven you, child of God. He dropped the charges. Calvary stamps on the debt of every believer, paid in full. He forgave us so that now we can forgive ourselves and we can forgive people that have wronged us. I'm done. I don't know who you are, where you are. And I'm talking to two people now. You need to make a decision. You need to know this Jesus that can give you peace, that can take the shackles of fear off of your life and allow you to experience freedom. If you don't know that Jesus, there are prompts that are going to come on the screen of how you can contact us this week to get to know that Christ. But then I'm talking to somebody else. You're not a part of a church. Perhaps you walked away from church. But this coronavirus has reminded you, you need Christ. But let me tell you, you don't just need Christ. You also need the community of Christ. You need brothers and sisters that can pray for you and pray with you. You need to be taught the word of God. You need to be somewhere that you can use your gifts to make a difference in the world. And that's what I'm going to tell you. New J is not a perfect church, but we do serve a perfect God. I want to pray for you, but if that's if it's you I'm talking to, the Holy Spirit is laying upon your heart right now to make a decision. You need to send an email, and we'll reach out to you this week, and we'll have a connecting conversation. Father, we love you. We thank you. Thank you that you show up at the moments of our fear. You release us from self-imposed prisons. Father, I pray now that freedom is coming to every home that's watching me. Hallelujah. I pray, Father, you would release them from the shackles of bondage. And we declare who the Son makes free. Come on, lay your hands on yourself and declare it. Who the Son makes free or sets free is free indeed. Father, we thank you that you're replacing our fear with joy. Thank you that peace accompanies us for our assignments. And thank you that the Holy Spirit empowers us to be witnesses in this world. Bless your people now. Bless every home, every house, every name, every need. We pray favor now. In that name that's above every name, in the name, the only name that matters. In the name of Jesus, we pray. When we believe it's done by faith. Amen. I love you. Can't wait to see you.